Until they run into a roadblock set by Kansas State. The Wildcats bombed away from three-point land to a 73-70 upset. The Boilermakers, no doubt, are looking for revenge in the Wildcats' home opener. Channel 3 Sports and the Kansas State Network presents Kansas State Wildcat Basketball. Brought to you in part by Budweiser, the king of beers, and Bonanza Restaurants, where extras don't cost extra.
October 14th, the unofficial transfer of tradition, the parade from Ahern to Bramlage. Tonight, that transfer of tradition becomes official. Welcome to a new era, Catbackers, game number one in Bramlage Coliseum. Hello, everybody. I'm Steve Dennis with the coach, Jack Hartman. The very first ball game in Bramlage. Magic night if you wear the purple. And, coach, since you had a lot to do with this place being built in the first place, give everybody a feeling of what it's like to be here for the first night.
Well, there's tremendous excitement, Steve. There's also a bit of nostalgia because everybody knows that we're not going back to Ahern Fieldhouse, which was such an important building in Kansas State basketball tradition. But it's very exciting here. This is a beautiful new place and a great basketball facility.
And I think it's going to be loud. Cat fans are worried that it wouldn't be as loud as Ahern. I was here for the Lady game earlier. It will be loud. Now let's talk about some of the other things neat happening in this ball game. Purdue is here, and their season ended last year because the Cats beat them in the round of 16. You think Gene Cady is thinking revenge tonight?
Well, there are a lot of factors involved here. Gene Cady, a former Kansan, grew up in the state, played football at Kansas State for a couple of years, a great Kansas State basketball fan down through the years, one of the great coaches in our country, has an outstanding program at Purdue, and had a great team last year. They had an outstanding game with the Wildcats in the regionals, and I'm sure that that's in the back of the Purdue players' mind tonight, and also Gene's.
I know you got to be a part of the opening ceremonies. We'll let you go and get to that. And coming up after a break, the starting lineups. You get to meet your new Kansas State Cats in just a couple of minutes. I think electric is a pretty good word for the opening game of a new Kansas State Wildcat basketball season here in Manhattan. 13,500 all gathered here in the brand new Bramlage Coliseum for another glorious K-State Wildcat basketball season. Oh yeah, it's very loud in the new Coliseum. They were worried about the homey feeling as opposed to Ahern. Very comfortable in Bramlage, very loud and filled with purple. Now, if you're one of those that believes in trends, Nichols Gym opened December 14th in 1911, the Cats won that one over Southwestern Kansas, and Ahern opened in 1950, and the Cats won that one over Utah State. Tonight it's the Purdue Boilermakers out of the Big Ten, an inexperienced team, much like K-State. It'll be a question to see how good this team can be in their opener. Both teams probably will be better when the season begins. Right now, let's get the starting lineups of both teams.
University Boilermakers and our Kansas State Wildcats. Here is tonight's starting lineup for Purdue. At guard, a 6'4 sophomore from Rock Island, Illinois, number 5, Bill Reed. At guard, a 6'3 junior from Fort Wayne, Indiana, number 25, Tony Jones. At forward, a 6'5 sophomore from Manatee, Arkansas, number 32, Jimmy Oliver. At forward, a 6'9 junior from Ada, Michigan, number 55, Stephen Sanders. The starting lineup for Kansas State. And forward, a 6'5 junior from Harlan, Texas, number 32, Billy Ray Smith. And forward, a 6'8 junior from Fort Lauderdale, Florida, number 42, Tommy Massive. And center, a 6'7 junior from Washington, D.C., number 44, Fred McCoy. And a 6'4 senior from South Bend, Indiana, number 25, Carlos Martinez. And a Kansas, number 12, Steve.
It's basketball for the first time in 1988 after a quick break.
To commemorate this special night, the Kansas State University Athletic Department would like to take this opportunity to...
Tip-off, Fred Bramlage just introduced to the brand-new crowd here in the Coliseum, and all the coaches in K-State history also about to be introduced, including my broadcast partner, Jack Hartman. Let's see if we can hear some of the ceremonies. Hartman just introduced to the crowd as the winningest coach in K-State history. Tex Winter just introduced. And before the ceremony's over, Cotton Fitzsimmons and Jack Gardner will also be introduced to the new crowd here in Bramlage.
The final game of Andy Longhat tonight for the Bramlage opener. Please welcome Wildcat legend Jack Gardner. And rounding out our list of honored guests is a man who has been a staunch supporter of the Wildcats, not only in basketball, but in all sports. A dynamic leader, please welcome our president, Dr. John Weeball.
President Weefall introduced.
At this time, we'll witness a true transfer of the tradition as Jack Carter, the first coach in our presents the game ball to the first coach in Bramlage Coliseum. Here's Tom Kruger.
They're ready for basketball in the new Bramlage Coliseum. A nice moment for Lon Kruger and all the former coaches in K-State Wildcat basketball history. And let's talk about the starting lineup matchups as Coach Jack Hartman joins me here at the broadcast table after that magical moment. It's Oliver, McCann, Scheffler, Reed, and Jones for the Purdue Boilermakers. Smith, Massup, McCoy, Henson, and Carlos Diggins will be the guard. There was some thought that Todd Stanfield would start as he did in the exhibition games in preseason, but Carlos Diggins gets the nod instead for the Wildcats tonight. Jack, that was fun, wasn't it?
That was quite a ceremony. I don't know about the timing of it, Steve.
Well, we're ready for basketball. Here comes the first tip ever in this building. And it's controlled by McCann. Scheffler got the tip. Purdue wearing their black on the road. As you see, the series records, 5-2. K-State has the lead, 2-0 here in Manhattan. Billy Reed, the point guard for Purdue. Into the big man. That's Scheffler with the soft left hand.
I think all K-Staters would like to have seen a Wildcat make that first basket. Purdue worked the ball well in their passing offense against the Wildcats' good man-to-man defense.
McCoy tries it inside. Rebound McCants. McCoy's sporting the new haircut tonight. Looks rather flashy. This is Scheffler at the top. Billy Reed, whose brother Steve played at K-State and then transferred to Purdue. Inside to the big man Scheffler. Reed from three-point range. Short. The board, Tony Jones. A lot of new K-State Cats to introduce you to tonight. Scheffler with the left hand again. This time on rebound, Tony Massa. And there's one of them, Tony Massa, a great athlete inside for K-State.
Very good rebounder, Steve. He's going to be a big factor in the K-State board play.
Steve Henson buries his first three-point try of the season. Very important for Steve Henson to hit those this year with Will Scott no longer here. This is Jimmy Oliver, and he hits one. Henson, that's a two-pointer.
Henson has really improved his perimeter shooting, and he's going to be a big factor in the Wildcats offense this year.
You look for him to be a 20-point man, Coach? You think Vaughn needs that?
I think he's going to score 20 every night, and I think they're going to need for him to score 20 every night.
Inside to McCoy, off the glass, too strong. Mass up the board, he got it. Tony Massive from Fort Lauderdale. Jimmy Oliver at the other end for an easy layup.
Wildcats getting back a little slow on defense on that occasion, and Purdue beat him down the floor for the layup.
Looked like Billy Ray Smith was beat going the other way. Henson working on Jones. He stops and shoots, and he hits it. Steve Henson with 5 quick points.
The Wildcats are doing a good job of setting picks for Henson out on the perimeter, and of course he's hit those two.
Gene Cady yelling over here on the bench that the score should be 8-7, Cats. The board says 8-6 as the walk is called on Tony Jones. Now they've got it settled. It is 7-6 as it was a two-pointer, not a three-pointer. So the Cats have a 7-6 lead with 17:40 to go in the first half. Gene Cady already hot. First game of the year, he's over here yelling.
Well, Gene is a very active coach and very into the game, very intense performer, has done a great job at Purdue.
This is Billy Ray Smith from Garland, Texas, into Massif, who sat out last year. The right hand, no good. Here comes Purdue in transition. Tony Jones by Carlos Diggins. Good defense by the Cats. Now they'll settle into the offense. Reed to Melvin McCants. The hook inside. No. And the foul will go against Scheffler. The first foul of the ball game.
Scheffler reaching over on the offensive rebound. Got a little too much contact.
Here's the replay, Coach.
You can see Scheffler coming over McCoy's back as he tried to get a hand on that rebound.
Scheffler, a man who bench presses 335 pounds. The man is huge. Trying to get it inside. McCoy got it. Shoot and touch off the glass for two. Fred McCoy is on the board for the Cats. 9-6 K-State. Billy Reed. McCants is 0 for 2. That's Billy Ray Smith with the board. Here comes Henson. Jones the defense. Blocked the foul against Tony Jones. Foul number 2 on Purdue.
Here's a look at that foul. Jones's hand is all right. I'm not sure. He must have got him with a body because his hand got the ball cleanly.
Coach Cady doesn't believe it. The 58 grad of K-State. Coached at Beloit High School. Hutchinson JUCO. Now making quite a name for himself at Purdue. 2 straight Big Ten championships. Best record over the last 8 years in the Big Ten. Steve Henson. Nothing but that.
One of the great free throw shooters in college basketball. Picked up where he left off last year.
The best in the nation last year. Your first substitution, this is Reggie Britt coming in for K-State. O.B. Berry will check in for K-State. And Mark Dobbins, check that. Lakeith Humphrey will come in with Mark Dobbins and Reggie Britt.
Also with the K-State lineup, number 31, Mark Dobbins.
So Lakeith Humphrey, the new point guard, or he will play some point. Henson will play point and off guard as Henson buries his second free throw. He now has 7 points. There you see Lakeith out there working on Tony Jones. Reggie Britt, the JUCO transfer from Coffeyville, and Mark Dobbins, a 4-year letterman. Billy Reed hits a 3-pointer.
Billy Reed on a 3-pointer and a well-executed play to get the shot for Reed.
11-8 K-State. This is Lakeith. Henson moves to the off-guard position. Keith Humphrey, a lot of confidence for a JUCO transfer in his first major college game of his life. Massif will try one. Dobbins scoops it out of there. Melvin McCants not too impressive yet.
I think it's very important. I'm sure Coach Coach Kruger is anxious to see how Humphreys handles the point guard and Henson over at the number two, or the shooting guard, because he wants Henson over at the shooting guard to get that point production out of him.
11-9. We'll be back in a minute. All right. One of the things we'll do for you tonight, since we're in a brand new building, is tell you a little bit about the place. Interesting fact number one, linear feet of bleachers in the new arena, 15,000. There, now you can enjoy the game better. We'll give you a bunch of those before
the
night's
over. That really freed me up mentally.
We got 12 more of those coming, Coach, so hang on. K-State back on offense with a two-point lead, and Dobbins shuffled his feet when he got the pass from Henson.
Had a good little play and a shot for Dobbins on that little movement, but he shuffled his feet before he could get the ball away.
First turnover for the K-State Cats. Here comes Tony Jones for Purdue. Purdue yet to make a substitution. Same five that started the game out there. Melvin McCants, the Jimmy Oliver, the Tony Jones, the Billy Reed. Scheffler, the big man inside. Jones will try one off balance, and it goes, a three-pointer.
Hey, well, we're seeing some pretty good shooting already from that perimeter, and the board play's been good. I'd say for an opening ball game, this has been pretty well played up to this point.
Both teams played a couple of exhibition games before getting to the opener. And both teams won both rather easily, although Coach Kruger wasn't too impressed with the win over the Danish All-Stars last Friday night. Henson off balance. That's an air ball. Rebound McCants. 12-11. Purdue's got the lead.
Purdue very aggressive on the defensive end on that occasion.
And Melvin McCants buries one for Purdue. We got a score to pass along. Wichita State in their opener up 50-34 over Central Michigan at the half. So Eddie Fogler's guys with a 16-point halftime lead. Substitutions for Purdue and K-State at this juncture. Lauren Clyburn, as you see Fred McCoy come back in for the Cats. Tony Massif will go out. Or actually, that's McCoy. Yeah, McCoy's back in. Lauren Clyburn, number 21, comes in for Purdue. He's the one with the J.R. Reed hairstyle, easy to recognize. And Big John Brugos, number 44, is in for Purdue. McCoy will battle him. Up for the rebound. It's Oliver. Here comes Jones. Jimmy Oliver, no good. Fighting for the rebound. Jones will battle him, and he got it with the left hand. Nice move
good
from
effort.
Tony Jones.
Good effort on Jones's part. Barry Lurley picked up that loose ball and took it to the hole.
Jones has five, and all of a sudden the Cats are down five with 14:04 to go first half. Lakeith trying to get it inside. This is McCoy. He lost it off his foot. Purdue basketball. Second turnover against the Cats.
Clyburn covering on the perimeter when the ball went inside to McCoy. Clyburn alertly dropped back in on top of Fred and forced a turnover.
Fred McCoy, the leading scorer who is returning this year. He averaged 9.6 last year as their sixth man. Inside to McCants. And he hadn't hit a thing. Reggie Britt, with his athletic ability, goes up for the board. His Cats, transfer from Coffeyville.
Cats dodged the bullet on that occasion.
Clyburn, flag for the foul. Purdue's got four of them now. K-State yet to make a foul.
21,
a lot of athletic ability on this K-State team. Coach, I asked Lon if he thought it was more athletic in general than last year's team. He said no. What do you think?
Well, I'd have to agree with Lonnie. Mitch Richmond was a great athlete, and there's no way that he could be replaced. And Will Scott, Bledsoe, some kids that can't be replaced. Even though I like this ball club, they're young, they're very physical, they're going to be a very good rebounding team, and they're going to play good defense.
You're going to see a lot of jumpers. Reggie Britt and Tony Massif, they get in there and make it happen inside.
They all look like tight ends.
This is Lakeith Humphrey working on Tony Jones, playing the point. Henson goes to the off guard on Clyburn. Playing a tough, changing man-to-man defense here. Trying to get it to McCants. There's Melvin. This is where he hurts you. And he makes it off the glass. Melvin McCants with four.
Real good pivot move by McCants as he took it to the hole. Got to have defensive help on that.
He's the 18th career scorer at Purdue. Senior co-captain. Preseason all Big Ten pick. Melvin McCants should be a big name nationwide this year. This is McCoy trying to beat McCants. The foul goes against Brugos. The Purdue bench doesn't like it. Number five on the B-maker.
Let's look at this Fred McCoy foul again. You can see Fred, he's got a crowd around him, but he takes it on up with a lot of strength. And Brugos had a hand on the ball, but he also had a lot of body on McCoy.
Scheffler's going to come back in. You're talking about some big men, folks. 230 is the average weight on Purdue's front line. That's only 15 pounds light of K-State's defensive line in football this year. They're monsters. Now, McCoy's a free throw shooter. You know that from last year. One of the best free throw shooting big men around.
Fred has a great touch in there. He likes the ball inside. He's a little inclined maybe to force up a shot or two every now and then, but he's got a lot of confidence, and we've got to have his scoring.
He was 10th in free throw percentage in the Big 8 last year. He missed that one. Rebound, John Brugos. Ryan Burning's into the ball game for Purdue, number 15, suffering from shin splints, should see limited play. Tony Jones, another three-pointer. He's got 8.
A good pick at the top of the key for Jones. And I like Tony Jones.
Lakeith Humphrey with the left hand for 3.
Okay, well, that is really going to help him to hit his first shot. That's a big, big factor in Lakeith Humphrey's career.
Tony Jones got it with the left hand, but it's going to be an offensive foul. The hoop will count. Billy Ray Smith, known for his defense, held his position well. So give the hoop to Jones.
Let's look at this again. Going down the baseline, now you can see that the defensive player has got his position established, but Jones got the ball away before the contact, therefore the basket's good. Offensive charge.
That's number 6 on Purdue, number 2 on Jones. They're one away from the bonus.
For Purdue, number 5, Reed into the lineup. Also number 22,
substitutions
Dave Barrett.
For Purdue, Dave Barrett will come in. 6'170" sophomore from Oxford, Indiana. He'll play guard. Brugos is in, Scheffler's in, Burning's in, and Billy Reed's back in. Humphrey looking for help from McCoy inside. Henson out top. Look at Barrett play the defense on Steve Henson. Into the paint. The pass. What a pass from Steve Henson.
Very great play by Henson. He drew the defense, dished the ball off. That's something that he's really improved in his game. And that's the penetration part of it and finding the open man.
Reggie Britt's first 2 points in K-State history. It's 23-17 Purdue. Reggie Britt from Flint, Michigan. One of the best JUCO players in the nation last year. Scheffler. And he was on the back of McCoy. Scheffler's got 2, and they're in the bonus situation. To the free throw line go the Cats, and that's a way, I'll tell you, that K-State wins basketball games.
That's good at defensive position inside. I think that might have been a little bit of a ticky call. I don't know if there was that much contact, but
there you see it, Jack.
There you can see it, and I'm not sure there's that much contact. He went pretty well straight up.
He kind of gave him an elbow going up for the shot, Coach, and I think K-State wanted the foul called then, and then they called it on the rebound. So McCoy will go to the line again. He's 1 of 2 thus far tonight. Short with that one. Brugos the board. Here comes Barrett. Lakeith Humphrey with the steal. Here comes K-State. He's got help from Reggie Britt. Look at the pass. Oh!
Great play on this off the steal in the transition. Humphreys took the ball to the basket, dropped it off to Britt to the staff.
Not loud enough in the new Coliseum. I think it's plenty loud. Henson the steal. He's got a trailer. He'll take it himself. He's fouled. A charge for the K-State Cats. They get within 4 with Henson shooting 2. Bill Reed with his second foul.
You can see the foul here. In the NBA, that would be an intentional foul, and the ball would be awarded out of bounds after the free throws, which I think is a good rule. The guy's breaking away for a basket. When you foul him, you force him to get the points from the line. In the NBA, you get the free throws and the ball.
Henson a little upset he didn't make a better effort at making the hoop, but I tell you, with him going to the line for 2, let's listen. There's 1. He's got 8.
Wildcats defense has given them consecutive steal and points, which is something you need desperately for that defense to complement your offense. Give it some help.
4 for 4. Remember, Henson made the 48 straight last year. We're going to take a break. K-State has pulled within 2. Steve Dennis and Jack Hartman back to Bramlage Coliseum with this reminder. This game is brought to you in part by Bonanza Restaurants, where the extras don't cost extra. And here comes another Bramlage fun fact. The truss weight, 100 tons per truss. Jack?
Whose truss?
Back to action. Purdue's got the basketball. Inside to Melvin McCants. You can forget it when he gets it down there.
Great execution by the Purdue offense on that occasion. They found McCants wide open underneath. Great offensive play.
Melvin McCants, a 4-year starter at Purdue.
Fred's got some room. Watch him force that ball up there.
Fred's trying to make something happen. Jimmy Oliver flagged for the foul, his first. I'll tell you, Fred's big enough to go in there and bang with those guys, weighing a smooth 230 himself. And he's fighting them, isn't he?
Like I said earlier, Fred, when the ball goes inside to him, rarely do you see it come back out. He's very optimistic, very positive. And you need to be that way in order to be a scorer.
Fred had a couple of huge games last year, 26 in one, 25 in the other. Had 16 boards and 15 boards in those two games. The 26 against Iowa State. He made 1 of 2 again. Rebound, Billy Ray, blocked by Brugos. Might have gone off of Billy Ray's foot, but they call it in favor of K-State. And once again, Coach Katie is irate. Let's look at it.
See if we can see this. You can see the block, which is good and clean. And
good call. Good call.
Couldn't quite tell.
I think it went off Bill Reed. Henson doesn't hit anything. The board from Oliver. 25-22, Purdue, 10:40 first half. Lakeith Humphrey on Jones. This is Oliver. Billy Ray, known for his defense, on him. Inside to McCants. He turns. He buries it. Melvin McCants coming alive.
Well, McCants on that turnaround jumper is very, very effective, and we don't quite have the size to challenge him.
He's a forward this year, so they got Scheffler in at center. McCants played at center last year. Billy Ray Smith the ball.
The only reason he's a forward is because they have to list somebody at forward. He's really a pivot man. Here comes Fred again.
He'll try it himself. Doesn't go. And Massup is called for the foul, trying to get the board away from Brugos. Number one on Tony, number one on the catch.
Massup attempting to get good board position in case the ball didn't go down, which it didn't. Well, it was a little too aggressive. Here's the replay. Now, you can see Tony Massup on the far side. He comes in there and gets a little too much arm.
Listen to the crowd ovation there. Orlando Rico Simmons has just come in the ballgame for K-State. And you know the story behind Lance. Out the entire year last year, broken kneecap, re-broke it in April. Didn't play last year, and they're hoping he can contribute this year. He scored 6 in the exhibition game against the Danes. Brugos is fighting hard against Lance Simmons, and he got it to go somehow.
I'm impressed with Purdue's accuracy from the turnaround jump shots in there when they're actually being challenged.
They got the lead back to 7 with 9:40 to go, 29-22. Carlos Diggins back in the ballgame. Jones will defend him. Back out to Lakeith Humphrey. Lakeith goes 6'1", 170, junior from Memphis, Tennessee, by way of Barton County Community College. Foul called against Purdue. Melvin McCants, that's his first.
Let's look at a replay of this. You see the ball going into Tony Massup on the turnaround jump shot. Actually, you couldn't quite see the foul.
Tony Massup will go to the free throw line. What a story this guy is. Spinal fusion surgery when he was 15, in a body cast for 9 months. He has iron in his spine, and he's playing major college basketball.
Wildcats forcing the ball inside to their inside people and drawing a lot of fouls, getting Purdue in foul trouble as they turn to shoot the turnaround jumper.
Massup makes 1 of 2. He's got 3 points. Bill Reed the rebound. Massup from the same high school, Boyd Anderson, is our friend Mitch Richmond in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Purdue's got the 6-point lead. Brugos from the foul line. Get up. Nice board from Tony Massa. K-State in transition. Lakeith looks like a fullback or a tailback looking for a hole as he comes down the court. He'll go against them. Brugos, jump ball. Good play from John Brugos.
Got right on top of Humphrey's little turnaround jumper. Ball award to the Cats on the jump ball situation.
Four rebounds for Tony Massif already. Inside for the Cats. Lance Simmons looking for help. Better get it in. This is Carlos.
Carlos Diggins is a guy that's got to contribute this. He's a senior, a lot of experience. He needs to contribute a great deal for the Wildcats to be full efficient.
Lakeith Humphreys, oh, two for two.
That's a real plus right there.
He's got six, both three-pointers. Juco, like the left-handed shot, huh?
Juco transfer coming in. This has got to be very important to him to get off on the right foot.
Well, he scored 11 in both exhibition games in the preseason. Jimmy Oliver, too strong. Rebound, Diggins, but we got a foul against Billy Ray Smith.
Do you use getting off on the right foot with left-handers? Maybe you should say get off on the left foot.
Seriously, how much will that switch things up as far as defense go, having a left-handed
shooter? Let's look at this replay here, and let's see where the foul is. Oh, they...
Oh, I don't know.
Billy Ray left his feet, tried to block the ball, and then went in after the shot.
Does having a left-handed shooter in the guard position do anything different to the defense, Coach?
Only if he hits him.
That's it, huh?
Yeah,
that's doesn't confuse him, huh?
Not really.
Charles White just checked into the ball game for Purdue, taking a break from the Rams this week. Kidding. And Chucky White from Monrovia, California, 6'6", 205 junior, as Oliver goes to the line. Threw up a brick. Jimmy Oliver, a freshman from Menifee, Arkansas, Proposition 48 casualty last year. 6'5", 205. He makes one of two. He's got five. 30-26. Cats down by four.
Purdue in a full court man press.
Simmons going by Chucky White. Gets it to Billy Ray. Out to Lakeith to start the offense. He tells them to move it. Carlos Diggins, a man that threw up 108 three-pointers his sophomore year in junior college. Massif was short with it. Big rebound from Oliver. Down to the below the eight-minute mark, first half. Lakeith Humphrey with the active hands. Out of bounds, Purdue ball. We'll take a TV timeout right here. 7:53 to go. Cats are down by four. K-State versus Purdue. We're back to action. Melvin McCants inside for a couple of more. He's got double figures.
McCants
with 10.
He's deadly in there.
This game brought to you in part by Budweiser, the king of beers. Beachwood A's for that distinctively clean, crisp taste. As Henson goes inside to McCoy. He wants to turn. He'll try it. Short. Diggins almost tipped it in. Billy Ray called for a foul in there.
A lot of big bodies underneath there. Got to be some contact.
That's number two on Billy Ray's. You get a good shot of Lon Kruger, his third year at K-State. 45-20 in the 2 years. Purdue, a chance to extend a six-point lead. This is Clyburn. Oliver goes inside to Chucky White. He lost it, saved it to McCants. Back to Clyburn. They call that on Henson? They say Steve Henson was reaching in on McCants. No, it's against McCoy. Tell me what you see, Coach. Not much.
I think it was Henson on as he reached back inside.
Well, they called it on McCoy. That's his first. I didn't see much of
McCoy.
Jimmy Oliver, no, in and out. Rebound, Clyburn, and he walked or double dribbled with it. You football fans, we know it's state final day today across the state. Good news here in Manhattan. Manhattan beat Lawrence in 6A, 14-7 to win the state championship. Other winners, Scott City in 4A, Lindsborg, Smoky Valley in 3A, Victoria in 1A, 2A, Pittsburgh in 5A. Carlos Diggins inside to Mark Dobbins, going against Jimmy Oliver. High off the glass, Mark Dobbins is on the board. 32-28, Chucky White back the other way.
Purdue getting the ball down the floor quickly after a made basket. The Wildcats got to make sure they get back on defense after scoring.
6:30 to go, 34-28 Purdue. Henson. Pulled down by Jimmy Oliver. Got McCoy, Diggins, Simmons, Dobbins, and Henson on defense for the Cats. Clyburn will try a three-pointer. He buried it.
Purdue likes to get that ball into McCants, and the defense has to drop on him. He's so effective, and when they do, they punch it back out for those three-point shooters. It's tough to cover them.
This is a nine-point Boilermaker lead. Big time for K-State here, down the floor. McCoy double-teamed all the way over to Diggins. He's inside the three-point stripe, long with it. McCoy will save it. Back to Diggins.
I think we can look for Henson to take over right along about in here, because with 5 minutes left in the half, and Wildcats need to close that up before they go in.
McCoy battling again against McCants. Got his own board. Back up and he gets it. But it's an offensive foul against Fred McCoy. No basket.
Here you can see Fred leaning in. Defensive player had good position. McCoy moves into him right here. Very good camera work to show that offensive foul.
The basket does not go. That's number two on Fred McCoy, five on the Cats. Reggie Britt will come back in, replacing Lance Simmons. Get a good shot of Reggie. 12.4 last year in junior college at Coffeyville.
Wildcats really need to toughen up now. Close this for two lead.
Henson moving on defense. Lakeith Humphrey on Ryan Burney. Trying to get it into McCants. That's what Purdue will try and do all year. Clyburn from three. No, sir. Dobbins tried to get the board. Lucky bounce to Brugos. Gets his own board. And Humphrey comes away with it, and Brugos is flagged for the foul. Some action inside, huh?
Big John Brugos is a factor in there. He's strong.
Tell you what, you know how big Purdue is. When in their media guide, they talk about how much each can bench press. I've never seen that for basketball teams.
That's a stat that usually basketball teams don't use.
Yeah, he's talking about how he improved by 40 pounds bench pressing over the offseason.
However, weightlifting has become much more of the basketball physical conditioning than ever before.
See the story on Lakeith Humphrey, his first free throw in K-State history. He makes it. Lakeith with seven. Barton County transfer led that team, the Cougars, to 24-9 record last year. Averaging 17 points for the Cougars. Got them both. I think you Cat fans are going to like Lakeith Humphrey before he's done.
He's going to take a lot of load off of Steve Henson's offensive ball handling and guard play.
Very confident for his first game in the big time. Ryan Burney, remember him from Purdue's team last year. Into McCann, stolen by Dobbins. He's got Henson, he's got Humphrey. Back to Dobbins, left hand, it's good. Steve Henson with a defensive play, and here come the Cats marching back. Three on Tony Jones.
Let's look at this replay. I'm not sure if Henson had position long enough. Coming out of this fast, that was a very well handled fast break transition. I don't know if Henson
got there.
I don't know if he got there quite in time to get set. The offensive man, to give the offensive man room to turn.
What about the guts of Steve Henson? getting in there against Tony Jones and taking a hit like that.
Well, there's never any question about that.
Gene Cady, 1958 K-State grad. That's not how you spell Kansas, but we'll live with it. Dobbins to Humphrey. It's only a five-point ball game now with 4:22 to go first half. Humphrey dribbles well with both hands. Very good ball handler. Gonna try it. Oh, he got the roll. Lakeith Humphrey hasn't missed. He's got 10. Three-point ball game, and the crowd is back into it. Watch the defense.
Wildcats very good on the defensive end, very active.
He got Massip. He got Massip. McCants had the position, and Massip was whacking at him. That's two on Tony.
Foul is on number 42, Tony Massip.
I'll tell you what, Tony Massip playing his first major college game against the likes of Melvin McCants. A difficult chore as we take our final TV time out of the half. The Cats are down three with 3:51 to go. And Jack Hartman back to Bramlage Coliseum with another fun fact. How many gallons of paint, Coach, do you reckon it took?
Oh, more than two or three.
3,000 gallons of paint as you see the jumper go off the glass and miss. Tony Massip the rebound. Lakeith Humphrey, short, finally missed one. Look at the rebound from Massip.
That's a great offensive play by Massip, catching that ball and dunking it while he's in the air.
This is a fired up K-State basketball team. Tony Massip with a noisy hoop. And they're within one. See if Purdue can answer. Woody Austin into the ballgame at point for Purdue. Against Billy Ray. Check that. That's Keith Stewart in at point, not Woody Austin, number 11 from Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
I believe that foul's against Reggie Britt.
That's his first. Both teams will go to the bonus with 3:22 to go in the first half.
You know, both teams offensively are trying to pound the ball inside to the big guys, and that's going to make for a lot of fouls in there.
A reminder, we will name a Bonanza player of the game at the end of the game. As McCants hits his first free throw of the season, he's got 11 in the ballgame.
That's the first Purdue point in quite a spell.
They are 2 of 3 from the free throw line. K-State gets the board on the miss. K-State got the bonus advantage 8 minutes before Purdue did in this opener. Henson inside the Massip. Steve will take the three-pointer. Oh, what a tip from Reggie Britt. And he's fouled.
Another good offensive basket on the miss. Let's take a look at this in replay. See if we can see Reggie on this great. Here's the shot by Henson. Ball kicks straight up. Britt gets in there on the board.
Brugos on his back. Look at Reggie react. All right. Reggie Britt with 6. He'll go to the line for the first time.
The Wildcats have had a very good run. And this is very important psychologically to know that they can come back on a team like Purdue, go into the locker room at halftime knowing that. It's psychologically very positive.
Tie ball game, 38 each. Reggie with 1 shot at the free throw line.
I got it out.
Count it. He's got 7. And the Cats got a 1-point lead. They were down as many as 9. Jimmy Oliver, pressure from Dobbins and Humphrey. Billy Reed will try a three-pointer. Oh, he quiets the crowd.
Billy Reed, a very good shooter, younger brother of Steve Reed, who played here at Kansas State earlier and then transferred to Purdue.
And Mike Reed, who played at Colorado. Another foul, this one against Keith Stewart, his first. Henson to the free throw line. Both these teams won a lot of ball games last year at the free throw line. Purdue had 208 total more free throws than their opponents last year.
That's not a very well-advised foul to put Henson on the line at this stage of the ball game.
He's already started the season with 4 straight. Oh, he missed one.
Boy, that's a rarity. Yes. See Steve Henson miss a free throw.
By the way, the 57th straight start for Steve Henson in his K-State career. Kicked out of bounds by Lakeith Humphrey. Purdue basketball. Two and a half minutes to play, first half, the opener in Bramlage Coliseum. Good basketball game. McCants will turn. That's his move. He's got 13.
Turnaround jumper by Mel McCants. Tough to cover. He just shoots it up over you.
That's what Gene Katie wants. 43-39. Look at Humphrey handle the ball. Henson. Dobbins will try a three-pointer. Yes. Mark Dobbins, the senior, the captain, with seven. Cats a chance to get the lead back. 1:45 first half. Henson, why not? His own board. Inside the brick. Turn. Too long. Dobbins to follow.
The Wildcats are doing a great job of rebounding on the weak side. In case the ball is missed on the original shot, they're really positioning well to get a shot to put it back in.
Gene Katie's telling his troops to settle down as Steve Scheffler gets a gimme. And they've got the lead back. Settle down, says Coach Katie.
Tell you what, this is a great basketball for this, for an opening game.
We're still in November. Henson from three, short. Britt up high, got a hand on it. Still alive. Humphrey comes out with it. And the Cats will take it easy. 55 to go, they're down a point.
32 seconds on the shot clock, 47 on the game clock. They might take it down.
Another foul. Jimmy Oliver, that's his second. He gets it just 40 seconds to go in the half.
Follows on number 32.
Let's look at a replay of this.
There you see him. Number two on Oliver.
Not a whole lot of contact as Oliver was reaching to deflect that pass coming into Mark Dobbins.
You see Coach Katie. That'll be something special for him to be the first opposing coach in the new Coliseum at K-State. Dobbins a miss. So with 37 seconds to go, Purdue can get a three-point lead.
They turned the shot clock off, 33 seconds on the game clock. Obviously, they'll run it down to go for one.
Keith Humphrey almost pulled off a steal there. We got 31 seconds now.
I'm sure they'll probably handle it out on the perimeter until about 10 seconds, and then they'll try to go inside, get the shot in there, or punch it back out for the jumper.
Billy Reed to Barrett. Well, those two really look alike. Oliver to Reed.
Handed it on the perimeter, looking at the clock, down to 16-15.
15 seconds. Steal by Humphrey almost. 9 seconds. Inside the Scheffler, left hand, they got it to go. Purdue did what they wanted to. Here come the Cats with one. Henson gets it off. He's short with it.
Good timing by Purdue on that last second shot.
So Scheffler gets the left-handed bucket, and Purdue will go into the locker room with a 47-44 lead. But keep in mind, it was a 9-point lead at one time. K-State with a couple of charges there to stay tight, Coach. Plenty of special things coming up for you at the halftime, including a live interview with athletic director here at K-State, Steve Miller, and maybe a special look on Bramlage Coliseum. Point leaders in the first half, Henson with 9, Humphrey with 10, Mark Dobbins with 9 for K-State, Melvin McCants 13 for Purdue, Tony Jones 10 for the Boilermakers. To 44, our halftime score. The Cats 3 points down. We'll be back with Phil Surratt and halftime activities in just a couple of minutes.
I think they're 4-5 all.
Welcome back, everybody, to Bramlage Coliseum. Halftime here at the brand new arena. And Coach Hartman, a lot of three-point bombs going up in that first half.
Well, both teams emphasize inside play offensively, knowing full well that the defenses may drop to cover inside. And when they do, then the ball is going to be punched back out for those three-pointers. And both teams for the opening game are shooting phenomenal. Both teams have hit 4-for-5 from three-point range, which is fantastic.
Lakeith Humphrey, 2-for-2 for the Cats. Reed, 2-for-2, and Jones, 2-for-2 for the B-Makers. What did you see on defense in that first half, Coach, in particular on the K-State side that you liked?
I thought they played very well defensively, keeping in mind that Purdue is a very difficult team to defense, because they have good size inside and excellent turnaround jump shooters in there, and McCants, Scheffler, Burgess. And then they've got the good perimeter shooters and Billy Reed and Jones. But I still like their defense. They came up with some very key steals and initiated transition plays. Quite frankly, both teams look very much the same. They're similar in style, similar in philosophy. Good, strong, tough man defenses, motion offenses with good discipline on both teams, and attested to by the closeness of the score.
All right, we're going to take a break, and Phil Surratt will return with the rest of the halftime festivities, including a live interview with Athletic Director Steve Miller. All right, we're back here, and Phil Surratt has a special guest. Phil, what you got?
All right, thank you very much, Steve. Of course, we're in here in the beautiful Bramlage Coliseum. 2 years in the making. It's been a long road to get things going here. A fantastic facility. As you can well tell tonight, the fans are enjoying themselves to the max. Let's call it that. You know, we had a chance to talk to Lon Kruger earlier this week about his home away from home. Let's take a look at it.
It's McCoy in the paint. He spins. He shoots. He makes it. He's got Mitch to his left.
The sounds of a Hearn Fieldhouse are now just memories. Kansas State University put the wraps on 38 years of tradition and now have moved into one of the finest facilities in the country. It was a dream that started back in October of 1986 when ground was broken for Bramlage Coliseum. The $17.2 million project is now complete, and now it's time to carry on the tradition of Wildcat basketball.
It's exciting to be a part of it, honored to be a part of it, because you know, so many quality players and coaches have gone into the making of the tradition at Kansas State. And as coaches and as players, this group appreciates that opportunity.
Kruger had some great times as a player and coach in a Hearn Fieldhouse, but now a new challenge awaits him as he coaches his first season in Bramlage Coliseum.
I don't know that the atmosphere will be that much different. I think it'll be a full house. It'll be a setting with the fans right there courtside. So I think once the ball goes up, you really might not notice that much of a difference. I think it'll be an exciting setting.
Bramlage seats 13,500 fans. The atmosphere is ideal, and no doubt it'll be a great recruiting tool for future players.
Well, it's an outstanding facility, and we're hopeful that recruits, when they come to campus, recognize it as one of the better facilities in the country and a place that they'd like to play. But I think hopefully recruits are going to make the decisions based upon the people, and when you consider that, the facility doesn't take on a priority.
The addition of Bramlage Coliseum to the Kansas State Sports Complex now gives the university one of the best sports venues in the country, and it will certainly turn out to be one of the hottest basketball arenas in the Big 8 Conference.
And Purdue is leading by a score of 47-44. We'll be back with more halftime festivities after these timeout on your local station.
And
Yeah, welcome back to Bramlage Coliseum. Our score, 47-44, Purdue over the Kansas State Wildcats. You know, it's been a long time in the making to get Bramlage Coliseum in order. Joining me this evening, Steve Miller, the athletic director of the Kansas State Wildcats. Steve, you got a beautiful place here.
Well, we're very proud of it, and the fans obviously love it. You can see by the attendance tonight, it's something we worked very hard to get to, and we're just very, very fortunate and very happy.
Are you impressed with the first night out here?
I'm very impressed. The score is a little bit not quite what we'd like it to be, but of course, it's not the end of the game. But we're very, very happy about the level of sound in here. We're happy about the seating capacity and the fact that everybody can see the game. We're very, very, very proud and very, very pleased about the outcome.
I'm curious to know maybe what Lon Kruger has told you about the place now that he's had the opportunity to be over here a little bit. Has he given you any suggestions to improve or anything like that? I hope not.
No, Lon feels very good about it. You know, Lon, of course, grew up with Ahern, as many people did. It's a tough transition, but I think after you've been here one night and heard the crowds and heard the people here, you know that the transition is complete.
Steve, of course, when you first took the job here at Kansas State, you said that your goal was to bring the prominence back to Kansas State University, make them right up there on the top level of intercollegiate sports. How is your goal going so far? Is everything coming into order the way you want it to be?
Well, of course, it's very, very early still, but I feel very good. I think that the basketball program, obviously, was well established before I got here. Our other programs are doing very well. Now it's very important for us to get that football program where it needs to be. I'm very proud to be involved with this university, and I think this is just the beginning. It's not the fruition of a dream, just the beginning of a dream.
I'll get to football in just a minute, but I want to ask you, what are some of the future plans for the athletic department and general operation down the road?
Well, we're just finalizing a new baseball facility, which we're enlarging to over 5,000 capacity. Of course, the new parking lots look just beautiful, have accommodated great, just tremendous numbers of cars out there. We feel good about that. The football facility, we're going to take a look at going possibly back to grass. And of course, there's our ever rebuilding of that non-permanent football press box that we always talk about. We'd like to get that changed as soon as we can.
Steve, really and truly, you guys have got one of the finest venues here in the Midwest, if not the country. You hope to really make good use out of it, I would think.
Well, 170 acres of a beautiful athletic facility. We had the state championships out here today. The lights on in that field, the lights here in Bramlage. It's a great multi-use facility. We're very excited about and very proud.
Okay, not to put a damper on the night tonight, let's talk football a little bit. What's the status with your coaching situation? When will you name a new head coach to the Kansas State football program?
Well, it doesn't put a damper on things. All that is a promise of things to come. We're going to name a new football coach, we hope, by Monday. We feel very good. I feel very comfortable. I've isolated who that individual is. This is not the time for me to make that announcement, but I'm very excited about it. We just need to cross the T's and dot the I's, and we'll get on with it, we hope, no later than Monday.
One last real quick question. How many candidates did you have for the job?
Well, we talked to so many people, legitimate candidates. I would say we probably had between 30 and 35 very legitimate candidates.
All right, Steve Miller, thank you very much for joining us tonight. We will be back with more college basketball right after this timeout.
Welcome back, everybody. Steve Dennis and Jack Hartman. You heard Steve Miller tell Phil Surratt that they've got their football coach narrowed down to one. As you take a look at the stats, I want to mention, you know the way we media types are, we've been nosing around a little bit tonight. We're going to throw a name at you. The word is that coach will be Charles Bailey from Memphis State. That seems to be the scuttlebutt here at Bramlage Coliseum, so nothing for sure. Just remember the name Charles Bailey from Memphis State as Jack takes us through the halftime stats.
You know, I've been very impressed with one stat, and that's Purdue's field goal percentage shooting. 58.8% from the field for the Purdue Boilermakers, the Cats shooting 42.9. Free throws, the Wildcats enjoy a big edge, 10 for 16. Purdue shooting only 2 for 4.
The lead changed hands 10 times in that first half. It was only tied once. The biggest lead for Purdue, 9 twice. Biggest K-State lead, 5. Just 4 minutes into the ballgame. We're set for the second half. The Cats trail by 3. 20 more minutes of basketball. Purdue will get it going.
The Wildcats in the first half enjoyed a 22-18 rebounding advantage, which is impressive considering the height disadvantage.
Scheffler inside. McCoy got a hand on it. Kept it away from Melvin McCants.
I think Scheffler left his feet.
intending to shoot.
And everybody thought he was going to shoot, and he threw him a catch when he threw the ball down.
Kenson inside missed a layup opportunity, but McCoy puts it back. Fred McCoy with six.
Another good offensive board effort by the Cats.
To the hoop. Oh, it's going to go against K-State. Tony Jones knocked over Fred McCoy, and that takes some work.
Fred had a lot of time to get position because Tony started that drive from the key. Let's look at this replay. Yeah, you can see that Fred slid over to get position. He wasn't quite established.
Number three on Fred. Also with three in the ball game, John Brugos for Purdue and Tony Jones for Purdue.
Tony Jones came up out of that collision rubbing a hand, looked like maybe he popped it on the floor as he fell.
Our officials tonight, Jim Bain, Mike Corey, and Charlie Green. That's Mr. Bain discussing things with Gene Cady and Tony Jones. If you remember the Purdue game in the Sweet 16 in Detroit last year, Kip Jones was a big player for Purdue, pulled down tons of rebounds against the Cats. He's not here tonight, or he is here tonight, as a senior co-captain, but he had back surgery November 7th, and he will not be back until the Big Ten season starts in January. So if you're wondering where is Kip Jones, that's the situation.
Tony Jones had to leave the lineup for that injured finger or hand. That's going to be a loss for Purdue because he was a big contributor in that first half as he was 4-for-4 from the field.
So Keith Stewart will go to the line, the freshman from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And he gets on the board. Makes them both the leads back to three. We'll see if Tony Jones can return. Right now it'll be Keith Stewart at the point position for Purdue. Just a freshman, 160 pounds is all. Henson. This is Billy Ray. Inside to Tony Massa. Couldn't get it to go, Scheffler the board.
Tony on a wide open turnaround 4-foot jumper. Got to get those down.
Inside to McCants, Massa, see how he does on defense. Scheffler another rebound. And he's fouled. He's got eight. Billy Ray Smith the foul.
Scheffler getting very good weak side rebound position. Let's look at this on the rebound. You can see McCants on the turnaround jumper, his favorite shot. Over on that weak side, Scheffler, big 6'9", 250-pounder, got that position. Hard to stop him when he gets the ball in there.
So we've got three fouls on Billy Ray Smith and three on Fred McCoy as the big man Scheffler goes to the free throw line.
Tony Jones back in the Purdue lineup. Got to be a sigh of relief from Gene Cady.
Scheffler makes it a three-point play. He's got nine. 6'9", 250 from Ada, Michigan.
Purdue in a full-court man pressure.
Reed on Henson. Scheffler didn't play in that game in Detroit. Coach Cady looked down the bench, and he said he was so nervous his legs were banging against each other. As Henson's called for the walk, says Scheffler needs to work on his confidence to improve that part of his game. K-State turnover, they're down six, approaching the 18-minute mark of the ball game. Three-pointer from Reed, too long. Board from Carlos Diggins. Boy, too strong. And Reed pulls down a big board for a little man. K-State coming out a little cold here in the second half. Tony thought about the tray. Over to Jimmy Oliver. This is Reed. Inside to the big man.
McCants wanted to dunk that ball that kind of slipped out of his hand and it slipped in the basket. Big break for the Boilermaker.
He showed some agility, too. He's got 15, Melvin McCants. Henson blows by Reed, now looking for help. Oliver all over him. Diggins out to do it. Henson talking to Billy Ray Smith. Jimmy Oliver will be called for the foul. his third.
A little bit too close. He was doing a good job of covering Henson, but he was a little bit too close with the body as Steve was on a dribble. He was putting his body on him. Taking advantage a little bit of that contact.
That's the first against the Boilermakers in the second half. Cats with two. Ryan Burney back into the ball game as Oliver goes out with three fouls. Mark Dobbins will check in for K-State. And Billy Ray Smith will go out with three fouls.
Mark Dobbins does a great job and is an all-purpose player. He's a good garbage collector, gets a lot of offensive rebounds.
I remember a big game he had in South Bend against LaSalle's Lionel Simmons. Oh, block from McCants, and Scheffler got the board.
That was a big, good offensive, defensive block.
Ryan Burning out there in three-point territory. Won't see him shoot it from out there too much. Tony will, though. That's off. Dobbins the board.
Dobbins picking up a loose ball, deep rebound.
The hot shooting to the first half, not apparent here in the second half as Henson hits a three-pointer to get him going. Cats within five, 16-45. Henson with a gutsy steal, but no help, and Clyburn saves it as Dobbin makes the foul.
Foul on number 41, Mark Dobbins of K-State, his first team's third.
Henson was that close to another steal.
Let's look at the replay of this. There it is, a good reach-in steal by Steve. He can't find the receiver.
Reggie Britt comes back in. McCoy will sit down. Got a final score from the Roundhouse in Wichita. Wichita State 98, Central Michigan 71. So the Shockers start the season 1-0 convincingly. Cats trying to do the same. Right now they're down five. Clyburn into McCants. Good hands for Melvin McCants. Turns around, he's got 17.
He's a big target in there. He spreads out, gets those feet apart. Big wingspan. It's hard to keep him from catching the ball.
Strong hands. Massive off the Henson miss, out to Lakeith Humphrey. Henson will try another tray. Oh, in and out. Dobbins a nice save, but
good effort on the part of Dobbins.
Right to Scheffler. Pace is picking up now in the paint. It's McCants against Britt, and he turns around for two more.
Hey, look, it's hard to let McCants catch the ball in that position. It's just almost impossible to stop him from scoring, and the Cats have got to figure out a way to stop that.
Lakeith Humphrey. He's got 12. 58-51. Gene Cady's halftime speech, apparently very simple. Get it to Melvin. As Burney tries one, he's short from three-point range. Mass up the board.
I don't think Gene Cady wanted Burney taking that three-point shot.
Steve Henson lighting it up. He's got 15. Two straight three-pointers. And I think Lon Kruger's halftime speech was pretty simple, too. Steve, shoot the ball. Both teams' big men, Henson and McCants, ruling in the second half thus far. Dobbins got a hand on it. Here come the Cats. Three on one to Lakeith Humphrey. Left hand, it goes. And the foul.
The Wildcats have handled the transition plays very well tonight. They've made the passes right. Here comes Henson on the break. Timing on the pass off to Humphreys was just right. They've really handled those plays well. Look at the midseason four.
And you see Clyburn lying there. I'll tell you, Lakeith really forced him to make that foul on him with a little up-down move with the basketball as Clyburn goes out with two fouls. It's a two-point ball game, and Lakeith Humphrey can make it a one-point game. Snuck it in. Keith Humphrey, 3 for 3 from the line, and all of a sudden, 58-57, the Cats, a 1 point.
Ladies and gentlemen, get the
home court. Brought to you in part by Budweiser, the king of beers, Beechwood Age, for that distinctively clean, crisp taste. 58-57, 14-27 to play.
When are you going to give us some more of that enlightening Bramlage?
You ready for one?
Yeah.
Number of ceiling fans, 44. In the ballgame for Purdue, it's Reed, Scheffler, Burning, Jones, and Brugos. Inside to Brugos. McCoy left his feet. Reed the miss. Scheffler up high. Brugos short. And it's Reggie Britt called for the foul. He's got two.
On number 31.
A lot of bodies jumping in there and banging around. It's hard to find one guy that causes a foul.
That's the fourth on the Cats in the second half. Purdue with two. Inside to Brugos. McCoy the defense, and it's Purdue basketball.
Purdue ran a nice little inbounds play then. Got that ball right under the bucket. Lucky to get out of that without a score.
Top scorers in the game, Henson and Humphrey with 15 for K-State. Massup with 8 rebounds. And McCants has 19, leading the Boilermakers. Ryan Burning into Dobbins. And they call it on Dobbins.
Yeah, I don't believe he had his position established. Burning took it to the hole with a lot of aggressiveness. Let's look at this again. Here's a cross-court skip pass from Reed to Burning. You can see that Dobbins is not quite there when the contact is made.
That's some of that Big Ten basketball. He lowered his shoulder and went for the first down.
He took it to the hole, didn't he?
Dobbins has two now, 5 on the Cats, 2 away from the bonus.
Not in the act of shooting, so they take it out of bounds.
Scheffler, Humphrey got a hand on it, still Purdue's basketball.
You can tell at Purdue on those inbounds passes would like to get the ball right under the basket. Now this time he opts to go outside with it.
Billy Reed from 3. Yes. And he's fouled. Is that a 3-pointer or a 2-pointer?
Passing is good by number 5, Billy Reed.
Only a 2-pointer.
Got this on the replay. You can see Reed on the jumper. Ooh, I couldn't see much contact there. We got Henson on a foul, but there was very little, if any, contact.
Yeah, the good news, it was a 2-pointer. He can try to complete the 3-point play at the free throw line. Another score of interest, KU and California tied at 11 in the first over there at that Great Alaskan Shootout.
You know, in basketball, you'd like not to comment on the officiating, and the officiating's been good here tonight, but you find yourself in so many occasions making a comment because it's necessary to comment on it.
Ryan Burning would like to make a comment on it probably now. He is not happy with that call, his first foul. And K-State will get the ball, 13-39. They're down 3. Humphrey, Massup, McCoy, Dobbins, and Henson for the Cats. He thought about it. Hand by Tony Jones, doesn't save it. K-State ball. See the way Henson blocked him from getting to it.
Screened him off. Wouldn't let him get to the ball. Good alert play by Henson.
Pass interference in football. See the free throw situation. Cats, 11 of 15. That's a ton of them. Dobbins. Humphrey, the left hand. In and out. A lot of those for the Cats tonight. Looking for McCants. He'll turn. Error ball. Listen to the cheer.
A very good play there by Lakey.
Henson went up high like he likes to do, but he's called for the foul. That high jumping ability of Steve Henson, you could see it coming. He left about the free throw line, I think.
You can see him gathering himself to try to time the block. There's a little ill-advised play by Lakey Humphrey. Got in there too deep. You can't see him. There he is.
There he
is. But he timed it pretty good, but he had to make some contact in order to get to the ball. Good call.
I wonder what the basketball court looks like when your head is above the rim. I'll never know, but Another decathlete on the K-State roster this year, Steve Fritz from Hutchinson JUCO. Him and Henson, both super athletes. Decathlete. As Jones makes the free throw.
I'm impressed with Tony Jones. I think he's a big factor as far as leadership's concerned for the Boilermakers.
He's played in all 63 college games at Purdue, and he's got 12 tonight, 2 for 2 from the line. The lead is 5 for Purdue, 12:53 to go. Dobbins to Henson. Much more talkative K-State team this year, I think, than last year. Seen on defense and offense. McCoy power inside, short with it though.
Fred got too far under the basket, couldn't get room to get the ball up.
Whistle before the shot. And it's on Big John Brugos, and he's got 4. That'll be the 4th against the B-Makers. Substitution time. Brugos will come out. Chucky White will check back in for Purdue next dead ball. Lakeith Humphrey, a three-pointer. No. McCance came out of there with the rebound. Everybody went down. Approaching the 12-minute mark. Listen to K-State talk to each other on defense. Last year, quiet guys. Charlie Bledsoe, Mitch Richmond, Will Scott. Didn't do a lot of talking. Both these teams losing a lot of starters from last year. Remember Todd Mitchell and Everett Stevens as Lakeith Humphrey knocks it out of bounds. And Troy Lewis gone from that Purdue team. Time for a timeout, 11:47 to play in this one. The opener in Bramlage Coliseum, the Cats are down 5.
Timeout, Purdue.
Back just in time for our 5th Bramlage fun fact, 225,000 cubic yards of dirt hauled in to build the new Coliseum as Tony Jones is short with a J. Another foul, very active officials tonight. It goes against Chucky White.
They cleared the side of the floor for Tony Jones for the jumper. Didn't get it down. It was an offensive rebound foul called in, or too much movement.
15 foul on Purdue in the half.
Number 5 on Purdue.
Boilermakers shooting 54% from the field. The Wildcats slightly over 40%.
It's been a cold second half, I think, for both teams. Carlos Diggins thought about it. Defense and yelling power. Inside the massive, the right hand. Nice touch. His first 2 of the half, he's got 7. 3-point ball game. Billy Ray Smith back in. Massive, Britt, Diggins, and Henson. Bill Reed, another 3-pointer.
Tell you what, Billy Reed can shoot the ball. Deadly shooter, and his shot selection is very good.
He's got 11 points, stretched the lead to 6. Tony Jones called for the foul. Billy Reed's high at Purdue is only 6, so obviously he's burned that pretty good. Tony Jones has 4 fouls now for Purdue, so he's in trouble and he'll come out. Stewart will check in.
See a replay of this foul. Henson on the dribble goes up with the jumper, and apparently Tony Jones got a part of his wrist. Couldn't quite see it on the replay.
Very, like I say, very active officials here in game number 1, I think. Henson back to making free throws. He's 5 of 6 tonight. And he got them both. He's got 17, leading the Cats, 65-61, 10:42 to go. So with Tony Jones on the bench with 4 fouls, it'll be Stewart and Reed in the backcourt for the Boilermakers.
And a lot of ball game left to have Jones with 4 fouls.
And Brugos, they've got a couple of players in foul trouble. The Cats have a couple with three.
You can see that Purdue's a little bit unnerved right now in this possession.
Reed will try another three-pointer. Short that time. Massup and Britt. And the foul goes against McCants. He's got two.
Follow up number 35.
I think it's typical to see a lot of whistles in the first game of the year, Coach.
Here's a replay of that last foul. Not a whole lot of contact in there, but I guess McCants was on the back. Okay, well, we've got some great camera work on those replays showing that action underneath.
I guess the officials are just like the players, anxious to get a new season going, so they want to become a big part of the game, huh?
Remember, you said that.
Reggie Britt makes the free throw. He's 2 for 2 from the line. Now he's got 8 points.
Come straight in there, guys. Come
another score for you of interest. Creighton's got the lead over Nebraska, 67-66 in the second half. Cal 28, KU 22 in the first half.
Short.
Rebound, Billy Ray Smith. They can get within one. Britt wants the J, and he got it.
I like the determination with which he looked for that jumper. He took it right up there.
Looked like Mitch Richmond, didn't he? 65-64. Inside, Jimmy Oliver back out to Reed. Neither team has really let that shot clock run down much tonight. This possession, it's down to 20. That's about as low as it's gotten, I think. Three-point try from Stewart. Oh, that'll quiet him down. He's got five.
I'm not sure if that's in the Purdue game plan to have him out there shooting three-pointers, but he's got it down.
Freshman, Massup working on McCants. Pulled it left. Britt had the board and lost it to McCants. Tell you what, Reggie Britt, you're right. Determination on the face here all of a sudden. Don't forget, Jack and I will name our offensive player of the game, brought to you by Bonanza at the end of the game. Reed too long with a three-pointer. Henson up high, loses it to Stewart.
Good recovery by Stewart. Took that ball away from Mark Dobbins, who had made a good play to get it.
McCants way out in the corner. This is McCants inside. Reed, now watch him turn, right hand, in and out. Another whistle that goes against Scheffler. He's got three. See if we see contact this time.
Let's get a replay of this. There's the McCants jump hook. I don't know, there's
don't
a bunch
know.
Of that contact in there that I can't see.
I tell you what.
I think the bodies are so big that the officials don't want to take the chance of somebody getting an advantage in there.
Looked like he went up strong for the board to me. A lot of substitutions for K-State. Dobbins comes in. Reggie Britt to the free throw line.
It's going to be interesting to see how long Gene Katie holds Tony Jones out of the lineup with those four fouls. Oh, there's a big miss. Big miss.
Fans here are yelling for Coach Katie to sit down and chant for him, and he remains standing.
Yeah, they need to wait till Norm Stewart comes to town.
They're trying to get it to McCants. I don't think it's any secret. And Massup is doing a good job on him in the paint. Two big fellas in there, Scheffler and McCants, Massup and Britt working on him. This is McCants. Dobbins got a hand on it. Somehow it went in.
Purdue got the bounce in, I'll tell you.
21 for Melvin McCants. It's a six-point ball game inside the eight-minute mark. McKeith Humphrey. Dobbins, this is a three-pointer. Oh, in and out. Britt Reed, it's K-State's ball.
Mark unlucky on that one. It didn't stay. It was in there one time.
I don't know how it didn't stay. 70-64, 7:47 to go. We'll be right back. It's a dandy.
Timeout on the floor.
Steve Dennis and Jack Hartman back to Bramlage Coliseum. Another fun fact coming your way, just because I like you. Number of doors around the arena.
Number of doors. I don't know. How many?
94. Back to the basketball. Dobbins to Henson. Cats are down six. He lost it.
Good steal by Billy Reed. Steve goes up with a jumper, and Reed got a hand on it, got it away from him. 6-point lead, 7.5 to go.
McCoy slapped it out of there. Good defense. Here they come. 3-on-2 if they hurry. Humphrey slows it down. He threw it away. Jimmy Oliver tried to get it to Henson.
But Keith Little forced that somewhat, got in the air. You got to know where you're going to pass the ball before you leave your feet. You get up there and then look for the receiver, and it's too late many times.
The ninth turnover against the Cats. Scheffler in the paint to McCants. McCants has taken over. He's got 23.
The big guys played volleyball then.
McCoy's going to see what he can do in there. Lakeith Humphrey. They're going to call that on Massip on the back of Scheffler. He's got three.
Purdue is doubling up on the Wildcat inside players, Massip, McCroy. They've got to take those jumpers out there. You can see Tony on Scheffler's back going in, reaching in for the ball.
I'll tell you what, Coach. Scheffler 250, McCants 240. I don't know if you're going to find two guys in the country that weigh 500 pounds in the paint for a team. They are some big boys.
Not unless you go to Green Bay and get that offensive line.
Well, Green Bay might not be a good choice. Scheffler is 2-for-2 from the line. He's in double figures with 10. And that beats his high game ever as a Purdue Boilermaker.
The Wildcats got to gather themselves and make this start this run. We're down to 6.5 with a 9-point spread. Scheffler could make it 10.
Short, board, massive. Every possession becomes very big for the Cats now inside the 6.5 mark. Lakeith Humphrey. Dobbins for three. Humphrey there. The foul goes on McCants. I tell you what, that bucket there missed by McCoy are the kind that he always makes. He's a high percentage shooter, and he's missed a few of those tonight.
McCoy's very... He draws a lot of fouls because he lunges in when he releases the ball. And it's very hard to guard him without fouling, even though many times McCroy is responsible for the contact.
He uses his feet real well, and he makes the free throw. We're talking about how big Purdue is inside. Be excited about this, Cat fans. Massive 10 rebounds in his first game ever at K-State already with 6:13 to go.
I think the Wildcats are going to be very effective rebounding-wise. Where they're somewhat lacking is height to play defense. There's a typical Mark Dobbins play. Took the ball away from McCants on the offensive rebound.
See if the Cats can convert that play from Dobbins. They're within 8. Henson puts it up, and the foul goes against Stewart. So Henson will go to the Lions. Good chance to get within 6 with 5:57 to play.
Let's look at the replay. You can see that Stewart just... I think the foul was before the shot.
Henson,
he's putting him on the line.
Smart enough to put it up in a hurry because he knew he had the foul, as Billy Ray will check back in, and Dobbins will go out. Nice hands from the crowd here. This game was sold out a week ago. K-State with 11,000 some season tickets sold this year. Phenomenal. Henson, 18. Reggie Britt in for Fred McCoy. Henson to try to get him within 6. Oh, nice sound. 19 for Henson. A lot of ball game left. 5:53. Can't ask for a better opener in the brand new Bramlage Coliseum. Reggie Britt made it happen. Billy Ray got the ball, and here come the Cats.
Well, here's the time to start that run.
Henson taking Stewart to school, but he missed the shot. Mismatch, really, Henson and Stewart. Jimmy Oliver, Billy Ray Smith. Another whistle goes against Massip. And that's four on Tony.
Tony Massip, very physical, works very hard. You can see him shoving on McCants right there. Reaching over the, but you know, who do you put the responsibility on for the contact in that case? It's an educated guess about every occasion.
It's an education for sure for newcomer Tony Massip in there. He's not going to find anybody tougher on the schedule, I don't think, than Melvin McCants. Stacy King, maybe.
Stacy King's not a physical player. He's a finesse player and a great one. But Tony's not going to see any more physical play from anybody else, more so than Purdue, I'll tell you.
Cants made him count. 25 points for him tonight. 75-67. The Wildcats need one of those charges here. The fans are getting on their feet to see if they can force it to happen. Lakeith Humphrey hits the left-handed J. 17 points in Lakeith Humphrey's first K-State ball game. Inside the 5 minute mark, as you see the clock appear on your screen. 6 point Purdue lead. Oliver to McCants. He lost control, but somehow it rolls in.
That's the second one of those that McCants has gotten down. He lost control of the ball as he takes it up to the basket, but it finds its way into the hole.
McCants is three away from the 30 mark. Henson, a three-pointer. He's got 22. We talked about him averaging 20. He's hit that mark in all three games if you count the two exhibitions. Five-point ball game. He walked with it. Lakeith Humphrey knew it. Big turnover for the Cats.
I'm surprised that Gene Cady hadn't gone back to Tony Jones. Here he comes now.
Still thinking like a coach, aren't you, Jack?
Well, you know, he's his best ball handler, his best thinker in the backcourt, team leader. You've got to have him in here at times like this.
So Tony Jones will come back with his four fouls with 4:16 to play. Purdue's got the five-point lead. Clyburn comes back in. Actually, I've got McCants for 27 points. We'll see who's right when the game's over. That is his career high because he had 26 in the NCAA tournament against Farley Dickinson. So make it 27 for McCants. That foul goes against Scheffler. He's got four. All of a sudden, Purdue's in foul trouble. But Gene Candy just looked at us, Jack, for some help. Did you notice that?
Well, they called Scheffler for going over the back, and after all the Scheffler was doing was
just... On number 55, Scheffler is fourth.
Reggie Britt will go to the free throw line. He's got 10. He's 2 for 4 from the line tonight. Oh, nice roll for Reggie Britt.
Got the bounce. Ball came up out of that basket, but straight up. Found its way back down in the hole for the point.
John Brugos replaces Stephen Scheffler. Three Purdue Boilermakers with four fouls. Brugos, Scheffler, and Jones. Tony Massip has four for the Cats. Reggie Britt, a chance to pull within three. It stays at four. 4 minutes to play. Here comes Lakeith. We got a whistle. We got a technical foul against Gene Cady. Ron Kruger doesn't like the whistle when it came. called the technical on G. Katie while K-State was in transition. Crowd here at Bramlage will start to riot. Gene Katie.
He really shouldn't have made that call when you're in transition like that. There's plenty of time to get the technical after the transition.
Henson with 23. His 24th will make it a two-point ball game. You have no plans to go anywhere. We got 3:46 to go. The Cats trail by just two. K-State will keep the basketball on the technical foul on the bench of Purdue. It actually was not against Gene Katie. A couple of his assistants jumped out on the floor and stomped their feet a couple of times. That's why they were flagged for the tee.
Officials will take a great deal more from a head coach than they will an assistant coach. They're very sensitive when assistant coaches start jumping up and down.
So Bruce Weber, David Wood, Tom Ryder, or Steve Lavin, the guilty party. Two of those four. Don't know which two. McCoy in the paint. Strong. And Clyburn will come out of there with it. 3:19, two-point ball game. Quick score, KU 34-32 at the half over Cal in Alaska. Here come the cries for defense from the Loyal Purple. 15 turnovers by Purdue tonight. The Cats will need another one now.
Surprised that Gene Katie's got Billy Reed out of the ball game. He's one of his biggest offensive threats.
8 seconds on the shot clock. Tony Jones is going to have to make it happen. Short. K-State's basketball.
They ran the clock down, Purdue did, and isolated Tony Jones, which is a very good maneuver. They cleared a side for him, let him operate one-on-one, but he didn't get the shot down. He got the shot, but he couldn't get it down.
2:30, inside to McCoy. He loves it in there, and he got it. Tie ball game. Out of bounds, Steve Henson. Tony Jones dribbled it on the line.
Purdue needs a timeout.
And that's exactly what
they're coming a little bit apart right now. They need it.
Listen to him in Bramlage Coliseum.
Tony Jones, the very uncharacteristic turnover there. He dribbled the ball out of bounds, and those things you do when you're a little unnerved, somewhat excited.
Couldn't have come at a better time. 77s on both sides with 2:19 to play. You see him rocking in the new barn. I don't know if we can call this place a barn or not, huh?
It'll be a few years before they can call it a barn. But some of that paint you talked about wears off.
$17.5 million to build it. Cost $2 million to Bill Ahern back in 1950. That's enough of the fun facts. The game's too exciting.
So you passed out some very important facts here tonight.
Well, thank you, Coach. As long as you enjoyed them, that's what counts.
Enjoyed them very much. Very educational experience.
Action. Lon Kruger looks on. You see it click down. 2:14. 77s on each side. Henson looking to go to McCoy. Scheffler guarding him. Fritz in the ball game. Billy Ray Smith, Lakeith Humphrey, and Steve Henson. Humphrey, dangerous pass from Henson. That's Reed on Lakeith. This is Reggie Britt. Oh, he gets high and he's fouled. McCants, he's got four. Reggie Britt, a very animated player.
Let's look at this replay. There's Britt on the dribble. I'll tell you what, it's hard for me to see the foul on those plays inside like that, because you don't know whether the contact and the foul is down below or up around the hands and wrist.
Oh, Reggie didn't make it count. He's 3 of 7 from the line tonight, looking for his 12th point and to give the Cats a one-point lead with this one. He missed them both. And Purdue's got the ball. Minute 50 to go. Tony Jones, their ball handler. Scheffler, McCants, Oliver, and Reed. They're starting five. Henson goes down, a block on Scheffler, into Scheffler. They're going to call that foul on Lakeith Humphrey.
He got a lot of ball. He must have gotten some hand along with it.
Well, we'll see. Every time it's been close.
There's the pass inside to Scheffler.
Well, we couldn't tell.
Lakeith Humphrey was over on the other side. Scheffler shielded the contact. Couldn't see it.
Scheffler 2 of 3 from the line. 65% or last year. And he bricked it. Three straight missed free throws. Britt missed a couple. Scheffler misses one. And here comes Tony Massa. Reggie Britt will go out. And he gets a nice welcome. Crowd on their feet. Another brick. Henson the rebound. A minute 34. Lon Kruger wants the timeout. I can't think of a better way to start the season. Can
you, Jack? This is a great ball game, and it's going to be a great finish. This is what we needed to start. Bramlage Coliseum out.
Running through the leaders for you, Steve Henson, as you see Gene Cady talk things over with his guys. Henson with 24. He's only missed one free throw. 10 of 11 from the line. Lakeith Humphrey in his first game was 17. Tony Massif with 7. Fred McCoy with 9. Reggie Britt with 11. And Mark Dobbins with 9, all in the first half. And it's Melvin McCants on the other side with 27 for Purdue.
I think the shooting percentage has fallen off quite a little bit, but I think the defense has gotten tougher.
Jack and I will decide on our player of the game, our Bonanza player of the game, here momentarily. I got to say it's between Steve Henson or Lakeith Humphrey right now.
I think one of the real positive surprises from this ball game is the play of Lakeith Humphrey. As you go transfer, you're always concerned about them, how they're going to adjust, but he stepped up here in this ball game and done a lot of good things and particularly contributed offensively, and I think that's what they needed out of that other guard spot.
Strikes me as a very confident player, Lakeith Humphrey. His teammates call him Keith. They leave off the luck for some reason. Minute 18 to go. It's a tie ball game. The Cats with a chance to get the lead. Henson in the paint will put it up, and he got it. Let's watch him play defense. McCants off the glass. No, McCoy the board. 52 seconds, the Cats up 2.
33 seconds on the shot clock.
Shot clock is 11 seconds different than the game clock.
I'm sure they're going to run this thing down.
But first, Lon Kruger will call another timeout. The Cats lead by 2, only 33 seconds to play. We're back to action, 28 seconds to go. The Cats have the ball. 10 seconds on the shot clock. Down to 6. McCoy's gonna do it. He put him up by 4. 9 seconds. K-State fast basketball. They're going to win it. They're going to win the opener in Bramlage Coliseum. Words are not necessary. 81-77, 4 seconds to play.
Purdue's defense had to play tough out on the perimeter to put pressure on the ball, which left a great deal of room inside for the inside people when they caught. So McCoy had room to turn and square up and get him a good shot.
This will be K-State's 17th home opener in a row that they have won. Five straight home openers, or make that openers in general. See if we can pick up a word or two from Coach Kruger here.
That graphic said that K-State has never lost an opening game in a new arena. There hadn't been too many new arenas.
Yeah, three of them. Nichols in 1911, Ahern in 1950. Well, Steve lost it with a second to go. And Steve Henson, I think, will be our bonanza player of the game. You agree with that,
I think,
Jack?
So. I think without question. From all aspects, defense, offense, leadership.
Bonanza Restaurants, where the extras don't cost extra. Steve Henson with 26 points. 10 of 11 from the free throw line. Our first Bonanza player of the game. There's nothing Purdue can do. They're a second away from losing their opener in 1988. Down four. Let's see what they try. To Purdue again. Gene Cady is probably not real happy about this K-State thing lately. We'll be back in a minute.
What are we doing?
How much? How much time?
Green with 11 points. Number 11, Stewart with 5. Number 21.
We'll get a quick comment, Jack.
Pardon me?
I'll mention Henson again, give the final, and ask you for a quick comment. He's a player of the game with 26 points unofficially. And Jack, how important is this opening win for the K-State Wildcats?
Well, I think it's very important because when you have a lot of new players, particularly a considerable number of JUCO transfers, confidence is a big factor. They opened the ball game, they played well, particularly those JUCO kids, so it really removes some doubts that they might have had. So it's a big, very important game for us.
All right, that'll do it from Bramlage Coliseum. Again, the final 81-77. Our next game, December 10th against Vanderbilt. My thanks to Mark Adams, SID at Purdue, Kenny Mossman at K-State, and Rick Dickens doing stats for us here tonight. It was a good one for the opener in Bramlage Coliseum. We'll see you next time.